108.9 on social media.
How can I find you?
Instagram
at Power108.9
and Facebook
at Power108.9.
It's the exact same thing. It's at Power108.9.
Oh, okay.
Power108.9, a station for the people.
If you're a content creator, social media socialite, influencer, or simply love to record current events, you need the joystick. The joystick is an essential tool for every type of digital content creator. It holds two or more mobile phones or tablets, allowing users to stream and record hands-free on multiple apps simultaneously. And it's lightweight and portable. For more information or to purchase your joystick today, visit our website at www.joystick.com.
The opinions and views expressed by this program are those of the program, program host, and guest, and do not necessarily reflect the views of Power 108.9 and its officials. We hope you enjoy.
From Christal with love, come on. From Christal with love, come on. Let's talk. Look here. I ain't the type.
All right. Happy Tuesday. Happy Tuesday, and welcome to another edition of From Christal with Love. I, of course, am your girl, Christal, and I'm excited about today's show because we are talking about our future. Basically, we're talking about all things future. We have two guests today that are both out here doing the work. They are doing the work to help the youth of today. And we know with everything happening in the news and everything that we see happening on social media, this is an issue that none of us should be turning away from. We all should definitely be dialed in. So I'm excited that you guys are joining. If you are, make sure that you pull up a seat, grab a snack. We're going to hang out with us for lunch. That's what we do every Tuesday right here on From Christal with Love. Headlines today, you know, pop culture. I don't really have pop culture trending headlines for you. We do know that Ben Affleck and Jennifer Lopez did get married again here in Georgia. And there was a big his palatial estate near Savannah. But outside of that, we've had some really, I guess, tragic news going on here in Atlanta. We had an actual active shooter in the middle of the city yesterday. And there's just so much going on that is it's unsettling. And it's like, I think a lot of people are wondering, where are we going as a culture? Where are we going as a community? And all of that points back to children. And that's why today's episode is definitely dedicated to that. My first guest is the director and producer for Defining Us. And I had the opportunity to watch the documentary. And what was interesting to me was that I taught first grade about, ooh, I don't even want to say how many years ago. I don't want to give you guys the number of years ago that it was, but just know that I taught first grade, and some of the same issues that I remember dealing with back in 1998. When I watched Defining Us, it's like all that time hasn't even happened, and we are still in the same place, if not worse. So please help me welcome to today's show, director, producer, Stacy Dewitt. Welcome, Stacy.
Thanks, Christal. It's great to be here.
Thank you so much for coming. Now, we know you guys had a huge premiere here in Atlanta on Sunday, and I heard it went amazingly well. People really responded. It's a very emotional documentary. Listening to both educators and children is kind of a mashup between the two. You realize that we really haven't moved very far in education and actually providing a space that is more equity for Black and brown children.
Yeah, I think what we know now is that we're really at a pivotal time.
Mm-hmm.
Defining Us is called Defining Us, Children at the Crossroads of Change.
Wow.
Is the tagline. And I think if you go back and you know, if you look at the what we like to call the cloud of witness, those that came before us, you know, if you listen to Martin Luther King, even in civil rights of the 60s, he said, you know, it will not be legislation that changes hearts and minds. Mm-hmm. Education and religion and communities are going to have to get involved in that. And I think that's what we're seeing right now. I think what we've done in this country, honestly, is done a poor job through, and I say this lovingly because I come out of media, I'm on mm-hmm. the media side of things,
mm-hmm.
but through media, we've done a poor job of really telling the stories of the children
yeah.
that are so impacted by the changing times that we're living in, and the great work
mm-hmm.
that there is a truly army of educators that are on the front lines of the culture war that's going on in schools right now, mm-hmm. and they are so committed to these children. So, yes, we do have so much work still to do,
mm-hmm.
and as my co-executive producer and a cast member in the film says, he likes to say yes, and, and there is so much work that is being done that people don't hear about.
Right, right.
And that's the issue.
Right. You know, you heard me say I taught school for 1 year,
mm-hmm.
and I remember it was the No Child Left Behind legislation had been pushed through at that point. And as a teacher,
right.
I realized that how hypocritical a lot of the policies were in the school system. But there were some statistics mentioned in the documentary that are shocking. I'm going to just read a couple of them. One, and the children in growing up in the Bronx have a 1 in chance. Black and brown children have a 1 in 10 chance of graduating. That's shocking to me. Like, that is horrible. Even today, 2022, we've gone through so much, and I hate to sound, you know, just stereotypical, but we've had a black president in office. We've had so much change when it comes to leadership and equality in different spaces. And yet education still seems to be lagging, you know, behind in being able to kind of level that playing field. In addition to graduating, it was like almost a 200% chance of black and brown students being expelled from school. There's still inequality in the school and how the children are treated and also the education that they're able to receive. What are some of the things that you, well, first of all, when you hear statistics like that, the viewers have to be shocked. I'm sure when people see the documentary, they're shocked that this is still where we are.
Yeah, people, and that's the really interesting part. I think there's two pieces or two kind of channels of misinformation.
Mm-hmm.
Number one is that, first of all, let's just be clear. Students of color are now the majority in mm-hmm. the United States.
Mm-hmm.
This is the majority of our population, and particularly our population in our public schools. So there's over
right.
50 million students going back to school this year.
Mm-hmm.
There's 3.5 million teachers in public and private schools, and 3 million of them are in public schools. So that is a high percentage. And the largest population among students of color are black and brown children.
Mm-hmm.
And so black and brown children are our leaders of tomorrow. They will lead us into the future. The teachers that are in the schools trying to change these statistics and put programs in place
mm-hmm.
and really lift up this population of kids need to be heard, and the students themselves need to be heard.
Right.
It's not that they don't have voice. They've got a voice.
Mm-hmm.
They have things to say. The question is, will we hear them?
Right.
And how much do we lean into and listen to and immediately snap our fingers and accept a narrative that reinforces failure and reinforces mm-hmm. old statistics?
Mm-hmm.
Because here's the other reality. The other reality is that so many of these kids are doing so well.
Mm-hmm.
So many of these kids have families who are working against incredible odds, and they have intersectionality with poverty
mm-hmm.
that is historical.
Right.
Right?
Right.
That they don't come to, it's not like they picked it.
Right.
Right?
Right.
And so, and they're coming into these schools. That was the impetus, quite frankly, Christal, for this documentary. Our company was hired to document a grant in New York City Department of Ed 6 years ago
mm-hmm.
that was focused on 9th and 10th grade black and Latino boys. And it was a grant focusing on assets
mm-hmm.
rather than deficits. And they
right.
put money in performing schools
mm-hmm.
and said, we want you to do better programs.
Right.
And I met a man named Paul Forbes, who's in the film, who was the executive director of that grant.
Mm-hmm.
And he and I became very good friends. And I'm looking at him and say, Paul, nobody knows these stories.
Right.
Nobody hears this success story.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
And that's about the reinforcement and the danger of a single story and the danger of those stereotypes, because there's these kids. Darion Allen, if you saw the film,
yeah.
he's our last kid. I looked at him when I was interviewed, when I first met him,
mm-hmm.
you know. We've been at this for about 5 years, and said, Darion, you know, how many of these kids are knocking it out of the park? How many of your friends
mm-hmm.
are knocking it out of the park like you do? He goes, all of them.
Yeah.
But you don't see that story in the American narrative.
Well, we've known for a long time that media likes to highlight the negativity,
right?
Especially when it comes to Black and Brown people, and we don't get the opportunity to share because a lot of times that's just not what the media is looking for, you know.
Right.
And just why is this? It was so important for us to be able to have this conversation today. Another interesting point in the documentary to me made really early on is that race was the biggest factor across the board, right? And that's interesting to me because I've always thought that poverty was the issue, right?
You know, we hear that a lot. Mm-hmm. And what I will tell you is the statistics really don't lie. Mm-hmm. It does not matter whether you are in middle America, you're in a, you know, in a wealthy family, or you are in poverty. Statistically, race is the key factor. And what I mean by that is that if you are Black or Brown, no matter where you are in the economic trajectory, you have potentially, children have potentially a higher risk or of a low success rate against their white peers. If you look at that across the board, what we don't want to make the mistake of, we had, you know, we put an advisory board together on this. I just want to give some credibility to this. NYU, Columbia, Male Black Institute out of UCLA, New York City Department of Ed, Los Angeles Unified, Atlanta Public Schools, all of them partnered with us on this documentary, right? Very, very diverse board, diverse group of experts. And consistently, it's that the truth, it's about truth and history. It's about what's gone on in this country. When people say we're post-racial, you know, we are not post-racial.
Right.
Right? I mean, it's sort of like, well, we want to pretend that's not happening. It's another way of saying we're not going to, in my humble opinion, look at this.
Right.
But the statistics are that we have to change the trajectory and we have to change the story that is being told.
Right.
So that we can move into a different place.
We can start to make change.
Right.
If you're just tuning in, this is, of course, From Crystal with Love, and we are talking with the director and producer for Defining Us. And this documentary was, first of all, like I said, it's done very, very well. But one of the messages that's clear is we are not post-racial. I think a lot of us became aware of that over the last few years with the administration that we just moved from. It became glaringly apparent that we have not moved forward in so many different ways. Aside from race being the deciding factor, like I said, that was shocking to me because you look at it and a lot of times we think, like I said, when I was teaching, we know that school districts are based on household income, right? And how much the house, the property value is, kind of dictates how much money the school has. And so a lot of times for me as a parent, especially knowing what I knew from teaching, my way to kind of deal with making sure my children had a better chance to be successful was moving them to a better school district. That's what we've always thought. Another thing that was interesting to me that was brought up in the documentary is one of the experts talked about when we try to teach people to be colorblind, that actually doesn't that doesn't fix the problem. He said, when I thought about it, I was taught to be colorblind, and a lot of times non-minorities think that that's the way to go. He said, so I just looked at Black people as a white person, but in that I missed out on the fact that there's a whole, first of all, there's value in the fact that that person has a different experience. And so just blanketing them and kind of whitewashing them, it does not work because you don't get to know the nuances and the individual experiences that Black person has experienced. Can you talk about that? That was powerful to me because I never thought about what someone that is not a minority, how are they able to help, you know? And he was very honest, like, that's what I was taught. That's what I thought was the right thing to do. Now we realize that's not the way to handle it. What we have to do is celebrate the individuality of each student and cater to that.
Yeah, this is so critical. I want to say two things. Number one, I will go back to the statistic before I talk about being colorblind. The first thing I want to say is that race is an indicator. So I want to be clear about that. When we say race is the thing, because what you're talking about in the outdoor, but race is the thing that matters most. But it matters most as an indicator of what an outcome is going to be for a child in public school. So what that means is that history that history of racism.
Mm-hmm.
So let's be clear. There's two different things. There's race and there's racism.
Mm-hmm.
And the long history of racism in this country has to be acknowledged, has to be addressed, and the impact it continues to have because we perpetuate single stories
mm-hmm.
and we perpetuate statistics from the past.
Right.
Right? Those things are all factors. And so critical that white people, and I'm white.
Yes, you are. Yes.
that white people are understand
mm-hmm.
what the value is of different cultures at the table,
mm-hmm.
what a black experience brings, somebody that's Latina, a brown experience brings.
Mm-hmm.
When we can all come together and actually embrace that diversity and celebrate it,
right.
It's amazing. And in the film, you know, at the very end, we talk about that because
mm-hmm.
George Patterson talks about, look, we want to bring everybody
right.
together. And there's a guy named Patrick Jean-Pierre in the film, and he really talks about it's not having one person of color in a room at the table. It's bringing the cultural experience,
mm-hmm.
the life experience, all into the room.
Right.
And there's an old saying that's my favorite. I'm a big music person.
Mm-hmm.
And the saying is, you know, being in the room with it.
Yeah.
And it's really bringing everybody together in the room.
Mm-hmm.
And this idea that somehow, because John DeVito is very honest. There, how do you be colorblind? I mean, what you are doing if you're colorblind is what he said. You know,
right.
I mean, you're looking at somebody and saying, I don't really need to get to know you.
Right.
I'll just make you white.
Well, and I think on the other side of that, because I was for a long time the only black student or one of mm-hmm. two black students in a white institution.
Mm-hmm.
I went to the University of Oklahoma where I was one of 500 black students mm-hmm. with 23,000 white students. And what happens on the other side of that is that the black students come in with the idea that I have to be this way. I have mm-hmm. to let go of what makes, you know, my culture and my heritage and what makes me individual. And I have to assimilate into white culture. And that does a lot for the self-esteem, I think, and psyche of students that are in those positions. My son went to school at a predominantly, well, there were four black students
mm-hmm.
at an Ivy League school at the time. And he said, when you are a black student at a predominantly white institution, there's a sense of trauma that goes along with that because your value, your culture is not embraced and you have to kind of distance yourself from that in order to be successful. So while I was shocked to hear that perspective, mm-hmm. I do know from my perspective that there's truth to that. Because
there's a lot of truth to it. And the thing I think that you said, what can we do? You know, I think the thing is there's so much to unpack
mm-hmm.
here. And a soundbite on the news is not giving you the story. And what's been this has been a life-changing process,
mm-hmm.
a transformative, really,
mm-hmm.
for me. Because when we started 6 years ago, even though I was in the work and I was doing education and we've been making documentary for years, it was a little bit more at an arm's length,
mm-hmm,
right?
Mm-hmm.
But this was a process where we're on the ground, in schools, with people. And I've learned so much because it's really about the relationship.
Right.
You know, when you can get to be friends with somebody
mm-hmm.
and when you have people in your life that don't look like you, I mean, across all walks of life,
mm-hmm.
and you have strong, strong relationship with them, that changes things.
Right.
And it's really about allowing and wanting,
mm-hmm.
desiring to get to know people and have relationships with them. And then the doors kind of break open.
Right.
I mean, it's really, it's fantastic. And
mm-hmm.
I mean, it's better than it could be when you stay in your own
world. You learn a lot. It broadens your, so, you know, that brings me to my next question. I want to know, what did you learn personally? Because, you know, me being someone that's been in education and been in entertainment, I learned from the documentary a different perspective, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I can't imagine for you working on this project for 6 years and hearing firsthand from the students, some of the students' stories were powerful. Yeah, I can't remember the young boy's name, but his father went to jail, and he talked about how he could not focus on school because his father was
mm-hmm.
in prison, and he was unfairly taken to prison. It was not his father's fault. So understanding that he's dealing with that, and then going to school, it's hard to shut off what's happening at home and what's happening at school. And I learned that teaching first graders. You can't, it's hard to separate what they're going, what their environment is from where they are for what, 6 hours. So Stacy, what did you personally learn? Like what touched you the most during this 6 year period? Hearing the statistics and the information from the experts, but really those stories, seeing the impact that the teachers made on certain students, that was powerful to me. But from your perspective, what stood out to you, and what will you take from this experience moving forward?
I think for me, what I learned was, first of all, for me, what moves me the most is the children. Mm-hmm. They, you know, children, a friend of mine who's a politician years ago used to always say, you know, I picked my parents well. Right? I mean, children show up where they show up.
Yeah.
Right? And they're so, you know, they come out with joy, and I mean, be around a 3-year-old or a 4-year-old, right? And it's what we do to them.
Absolutely.
At the hands of adults. Mm-hmm. Right? And so for me, the what spoke to me most was the children. That said, a couple of things. First of all, I learned a lot about what I didn't know, mm-hmm. How much I did not know, and honestly, how much not I wasn't aware of because I just wasn't looking.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Because people get in their own lives.
Yeah.
Right? Also, a lot of vulnerability and humility, and I think so many things by just immersing into the families and the stories. I got to be, you know, really good friends with Darion's mom.
Mm-hmm. Oh, wow.
And she and I, you know, connected on a level because we both have children and I have a son,
mm-hmm.
you know, and that's what I mean about relationship.
Yeah.
I talked to her not long ago, and Darion was driving across the country from Wisconsin because he just graduated from Wisconsin. He's now in film school at Loyola, so
nice.
He's doing really great. And he's driving across the country, and I'm talking to Dana on the phone, and she said, yeah, he's on his way back. He and a buddy are driving across the country.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought to myself, you know, she's a little nervous about that.
Yeah. I was like, I immediately, as a mother of a son, I'm like, okay, your son's driving across country. We're concerned.
Yeah. No, that's right.
Yeah.
But what would have never happened to me before is that immediately I thought, my son is Darion's age.
Yeah.
And when he's driving across country, because he had just driven to Denver.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I mean, he's a little bit older than Darion, but he just driven to Denver because he was moving to Denver.
Mm-hmm.
And I was worried about him getting in a car accident and hoping somebody would help him.
Right. Wow.
Mm. Right? Those are two very different things that are going through. And so when you get to know someone, you're breaking through a lot of those things. And I think the other thing that, I mean, Paul Forbes and I have gotten to be very good friends. So the second thing, I'm going to give you three things. The second thing was I learned you can be uncomfortable.
Right.
That you can be uncomfortable, and it's okay to say, you know what, I'm a little uncomfortable.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Help me here.
Right.
Right.
That's it. That's it. I'm acknowledging I'm uncomfortable. I need help. And then
right.
it goes away.
Right. Help me here.
Mm-hmm.
Help me understand. Help
right.
me do this differently.
Right.
Right. And I have found an amazing amount of grace in those conversations.
Right.
Right. And then the third thing is what you said. And that is, as a white person, it had not occurred to me. The film talks about it, and it's why we put it in the film.
Mm-hmm.
What you have to navigate in living in both worlds.
Mm-hmm.
Right. This chameleon, and then Allison Towery backs it up and says, you know, we bring great culture, richness, your family, who you are, the identity these children are. I mean, it's who you are.
Yeah.
I mean, and now I've got to walk through a white culture, and I got to live over there when I'm supposed to live over there, and I got to live over here when I'm supposed to live over here. And as Yolanda says, I think I'm one thing, I'm walking into society, there's a prescription for me that's something else as a child, and I'm bumping into walls. I've got to figure out how to navigate that.
Right.
So all of that, obviously, I directed the film, so I've heard it over and over and over, but it has become...
It's permeated. It's got in there.
It's become a truth.
Yeah.
Do you see what I mean?
Absolutely. No, absolutely. That makes a lot of sense. So we've been talking about this documentary. It comes out today.
It's out today.
So mm-hmm. you can actually go and see it. And I think any parent, I don't care what your racial background is, needs to see this film. I think anyone that's interested in education and just children, period. It's something that goes across ages and cultures. And like I said, it was done so well because you get a chance to really hear from the heart of students. I think my favorite part about the documentary is seeing the impact that one teacher can make on a child's life. You know, hearing a teacher that would bring an extra apple because the student didn't have food at home, and she realized that, and without making him feel uncomfortable and without making him feel embarrassed, kind of jumped in and filled that need. And then seeing him graduate and shout her out as his mentor and best friend, you all did a beautiful job.
Well, I appreciate that. And if you come to our website at definingus.org, mm-hmm. it's right there on the homepage. Download the film now. We're on iTunes, we're on Prime, we're on every video on demand platform. And I do think it's an opportunity to build a bridge.
Right, absolutely.
And I think it's it just resonates with, we're getting great feedback in the pre-screenings and that sort of stuff. And it just, we all need to get to a place where we know mm-hmm. each other mm-hmm. better. But also I think it's really, really critical, I'm just going to say, at this time in our country,
right.
that we protect that conversation.
Mm-hmm. And it's okay if it makes you uncomfortable. I think that's the biggest thing. For so long, mm-hmm. we didn't want to be uncomfortable. So we wanted to say we wanted to put things out that made everyone feel good. But some of the things that are happening in our country are not things that are going to make us feel good. So we have mm-hmm. to be okay with being uncomfortable. We have to be okay with saying, I don't understand.
Right.
And then at that point, we can start to build a barrier. So thank you so much, Stacy. You guys make sure that you go to the website, download and watch the film, leave comments, leave reviews.
Absolutely. So, please. We want your comments. We want your feedback. And yeah, we're excited to be here. And thanks for
absolutely.
Thanks for having us.
Absolutely. Thank you. Stay right there. We're coming right back with a music executive in Atlanta that figured out the way to impact children was to give them what they were interested in. We're coming right back with Ric Ross. Stay tuned. This is From Christal With Love.
Content creator, social media socialite, influencer, or simply love to record current events, you need the joystick. The joystick is an essential tool for every type of digital content creator. It holds two or more mobile phones or tablets, allowing users to stream and record hands-free on multiple apps simultaneously. And it's lightweight and portable. For more information or to purchase your joystick today, visit our website at www.joystick.com.
Yo, it's Michael McFadden of Power 108.9, and I want to ask you a question. Are you looking for a new house? If so, you need to holler at our guy, the mortgage guy, Alvin Jameson. AlvinJameson.com. Yeah, Alvin like the chipmunk, and Jameson like that fine whiskey. Not only can he help you on the purchase of that new home, he can also assist you on that refinance as well. So whether it's FHA, conventional, and of course that VA home loan that you're sitting on right now, yo, call Alvin Jameson. 404-587-9033. Once again, 404-587-9033. Trust the guy we trust here at Power 108.9, Alvin Jameson. AlvinJameson.com, or just call him, 404-587-9033. And of course, tell him you heard it right here on Power 108.9. Let's go. Yo, it's Michael McFadden for our friends over at Credit Building Professionals. You know what they do? They help their clients achieve better credit. How? Late payments, fraud, liens, charge-offs, student loans. They do it all. Get results in 30 to 90 days, and it's very simple to contact them. Hit them up on their website, creditbuildingprofessionals.com, or give them a call, 678-447-447. 678-447-2012. Once again, 678-447-2012. Tell them you heard it on Power 108.9. What up, Credit Craig?
My powerful and pristine people, it's your boy E-Money, your favorite engineer. Check it out. If you want to get involved with Power 108.9 as far as partnerships and advertising, if you want to reach our 50,000 plus listeners and viewers per week, please email power1089ads@gmail.com. That's power1089ads@gmail.com. Speak to our marketing director so we can get you set up and ready to go. Let us help you reach your targeted audience and expand your brand.
Question, what's the only station where you can get R&B, hip-hop, pop, and talk radio? Time's up.
Power 108.9, a station for the people.
Hi, Queens. Welcome to the Ole Tony Experience in Atlanta, your source for all things fashion and hair.
Yeah. Baby, I'm just trying to let my hair down.
Please visit us online at shopoletony.com and follow us on Instagram at oletonystar.
Honest question. Do you really know what's going on in the Metro Atlanta real estate market?
I own half of Atlanta. You believe that? Real estate.
Team Todd Realty Group.
Atlanta has become a hotbed for real estate, and it's consistently growing by the day. Nikita Todd and the good folks with Team Todd Realty Group are here to assist you with any of your real estate needs.
Looking to buy a house?
What I would tell a first-time home buyer is to make sure that you have saved adequately.
Thinking about that investment property?
You reach out to me because, of course, I have a lot of resources.
Or trying to sell your house?
It's always best to consult with your realtor first. We have options to get your house on the market as quickly as possible. And we also have other options to where you can purchase with cash and sell your home later. So it's always best to consult a realtor because we have a lot of tricks of the trade that not everybody's privy to.
Don't wait another minute. Go to www.teamtoddrealty.com for more information.
Team Todd Realty Group.
If you've never been to Power 108, let me tell you something. It smells amazing. I don't know where the smell is coming from. It looks vacuumed. The microphone has definitely been sanitized. Okay, like, dude, this is a no COVID zone, okay? This is a no germ zone, okay?
Yes.
I wanted to cough, but I'm scared.
We can do surgery.
If I cough, I feel like somebody's gonna come get me. It's gonna be like, girl, come with me.
Power 108.9, a station for the people.
Yo, what's going on, y'all? This is Malik McFadden, and did you know that you can listen to Power 108.9 24/7? Just visit the website power108.9.com or simply say, Alexa, play Power 108.9. Yeah.
Okay, we are back. What a great conversation with Stacy Dewitt. And now we got one of my good friends and someone I've looked up to in the music industry for a long time. Ric Ross is a music executive and a radio music and Hall of Fame inductee. He is, but most importantly, he is someone that is an advocate for the community, and he always has been. And it's an honor and a pleasure to have an opportunity to work with you and to have you here today. So welcome, Ric.
Thank you. Thank you for inviting me.
Absolutely. Now, you probably don't remember this. I remember when I first started as a music publicist back in the early 2000s, I went to an event that that MEG had, and I heard statistics of how many students in Atlanta, how many high school students wanted to have a career in music.
Yeah.
It was just about all of them. I mean, it was a huge, the numbers were huge.
Yes.
And it was like, what are these students interested in? When you think about young people and how to keep them engaged and how to keep them, you know, on the right path, finding something that they connect with was important. And at that time, I mean, this was like 2005, 2006 in the city. Atlanta was on fire. Music culture is a big thing here.
Absolutely.
And I remember hearing you speak and you saying, you know, if we want to help these kids, we've got to be able to, number one, expose them to what they're interested in, and then also educate them on how many other opportunities there are in music. They can be an engineer. They can be a producer. They could be a music publicist like I was. There's so many different things that they can do that can still connect them with what they were interested in.
Absolutely.
Is that what motivated you to start MEG, the Music Education Group?
Yeah, that's one part. 17 years ago when I came up with this idea, you know, being in the industry for the last 36 years, working with artists, I mean, you know, from, you know the eight, yeah. you know the list.
He's worked with everybody.
I learned a lot being with those artists. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I learned that they really didn't know a whole lot about their business.
Absolutely.
Even though they were talented.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a lot of artists that sold millions of records.
Mm-hmm.
They would ask, they would always come back, you know, when we would be out on the road and ask me different questions about just various things that I thought that they should know.
Right.
Whether it was about publishing mm-hmm. or, you know, of course, you know, they were very curious about radio and how that whole thing worked. Mm-hmm. So I was, I had taken a hiatus from the business for a couple of years.
Mm-hmm.
And I was sitting around the house and, I mean, this vision just came to me about music education group. I've always worked with kids.
Mm-hmm.
Since I was in high school, I worked summer camps at different, you know, parks and rec centers. So I've always loved working with kids. But when I came up with the music education group, it was really to teach kids about the business part of the industry.
Okay.
And also teaching them about life skills.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So, you know, it just kind of merged together, and you know, we came up with the music education group, and the program has definitely evolved over the last 17 years to mm-hmm. what we, you know, we have now. But music was the hook,
right?
It
right.
was the hook to get their attention,
right?
To expose them to these other opportunities, but most important to give them a foundation and to teach them about life, and
right.
give them life skills.
Right.
You know,
and it kind of shows them that someone is vested. Someone cares. I think that's, you know,
absolutely.
What that was apparent in the documentary Defining Us is sometimes just knowing that one person cares. You know, you guys are in the school after school programs so that those kids know there's somebody here that's interested in what I'm interested in and making sure that, you know, what I want to do, I have some information about that.
Kids have been let down so much.
Mm-hmm.
They've been lied to. And, you know, it's hard to get their to gain their trust.
Right, right.
Because they've been hurt so many times.
Mm-hmm.
You know, especially kids from single parent homes. You know, a friend of mine who, you know, I do a lot of work at Best Academy, the all-boys school. I've actually been at that school probably over 10, 12 years.
That's awesome.
Doing work with that school. But a friend of mine came to me one day, you know, and I was talking about a couple of the kids in the class, and she said, I said, these are some bad kids. And she said, Rick, she said, they're not bad.
Yeah.
They come from bad situations.
Right.
So when you walk in the classroom and you see a kid with his head down on the desk, kid probably hadn't slept.
Right. Or ate.
Hadn't ate.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you don't know what he went through that night.
Right.
Mom could have been being beat up all night or
mm-hmm.
on drugs or
mm-hmm.
whatever the case may
mm-hmm.
be. You know, so, you know, they're hungry. They probably didn't eat last night.
Right.
So how you expect for a kid to focus on work when he hasn't had anything to eat?
And the home is all over the place. I remember when I taught first grade one year, that was not my calling. But I remember a little girl in class, I would tell, you know, they come to class and, you know, she didn't have her homework. And she didn't have her homework almost any day, you know. And I took her outside and I said, well, no, I didn't. At first I asked her, I got on her in front of the rest of the students. I said, Monique, your homework isn't done. And she said, well, Miss Christal, my mom got drunk again last night, and the electricity, we don't have any electricity in the house.
Yeah.
And this is a first grader, and she didn't know. The other kids started laughing, but she, and you could tell her face just dropped.
Yeah.
And so I took her outside and I said, okay, we don't share everything with everybody. If that happens, you come and talk to me and
right.
we'll figure it out.
Right.
So the next time we were going around passing homework in, and Monique said, Miss Christal, I don't have my homework. That thing that we don't talk about in public happened again. But, you know, you think about
yeah.
that. How can a first grade, how is she supposed to be
yeah.
able to focus in class if there's no electricity at home
yeah.
and mom is drunk,
yeah.
you know? And that let me know. I knew I wasn't supposed to teach, but it also let me know how important it is for us to support programs like the one you have
yes.
and the documentary that Stacy did earlier. So you are doing something to raise money for your nonprofit, and I'm so thankful that the city of South Fulton has stepped up to partner with you.
Yes.
Tell us about your 12-hour treadmill-a-thon. They gonna have you running on a treadmill to save the kids.
Yeah, well, of course, I'm an avid runner. I've run marathons. You know, I call myself now an endurance athlete.
Okay.
So I've went past the marathon.
You're just at an endurance.
Yeah, so now, you know, anything past a marathon, which is 26.2 miles, is considered an ultra.
Mm.
So
how many miles do you run, Rick?
Well, my first ultra that I did back in March, I ran 33 miles.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah, 9 hours and 40 minutes.
You ran for 9 hours?
Yeah, ran for 9 hours. So you know, so my wife, it drives her crazy. But I've always been a runner.
Okay.
You know, since I was little. My mom said I would shoot out the door butt naked and start running. Oh, wow.
See, I thought you started this later in life. So this is
No. I've always been a runner. Mm-hmm. I'm not a sprinter. I've always loved this distance.
Okay.
You know, in high school I ran cross country and played soccer. So, you know, it's always been, you know, the long distance thing. So, the treadmill thon came about during COVID. I wanted to do something to raise money for an organization. So for 14 days, I ran twice a day on the treadmill, and we raised money, and we donated that money to Hosea Helps.
Mm-hmm, okay.
So, you know, every year I try to do a fundraiser on my birthday. So Friday, I'll be turning 56.
Okay, wow.
And I say, you know what? I want to do this 12-hour treadmill-a-thon where people can come out and exercise. They can come and walk. You know, I'm not asking anybody to jump on the treadmill with
not
me
for
12 hours.
Rick, because I'm going to tell you, I told you I've been working out every day. But I'm not, at 45 minutes, I'm looking at my treadmill like, I'm about to get off of here. I hated it. I hate all 45 minutes, Rick. All 45 minutes. I am counting down the minutes. And when I get to 45, I'm off. I am off. But I got you for 45 minutes. Yeah. I can't do much more than that.
So the purpose was to come out, hang out with me for my birthday, but also make a donation.
Right.
We are in the process of building a mobile technology center.
Okay.
We've been getting a lot of requests to come to other areas in Atlanta and throughout the parts of Georgia to do programming.
Mm-hmm.
Unfortunately, you know, there are not a lot of rec centers in rural areas.
Right, right.
They don't have a place for their teens to go.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, we want to go into, you know, these other smaller cities and partner with local organizations and bring the bus down there and just expose the kids to the magic of art.
Yeah.
Through entertainment and music and film, digital media and all of that.
Mm-hmm.
So, we've had requests to come to LaGrange, and Brunswick, and Athens. And,
oh, wow,
you know,
those rural areas.
Yeah, these rural areas, and people don't understand that the state of Georgia is made up of 159 counties.
People do not understand that. They think it's Atlanta.
Atlanta, you know, Decatur and mm-hmm. Gwinnett and Carl.
Marietta,
yeah,
right.
Yeah, so, but, you know, it's 159 counties, so you just imagine they're in every county, there are kids that love music.
Right,
they love video games. They love technology. Mm-hmm. So we just want to go in and plant seeds in these various markets
mm-hmm.
and expose these young people to, you know, just stimulate them and mm-hmm. get them to be, you know, be more creative. So on Friday, I'm asking people to come out to Welcome All Park,
yes,
which is in the city of South Fulton. Welcome All Park is actually the biggest rec center in the city.
Mm-hmm.
And,
oh, wow.
And
it's
they
very
have,
nice.
Yeah, and they have an indoor track above the above the basketball court, so mm-hmm. you can come in and walk and make a donation. We're going to have a young lady who's going to be doing smoothies. Later on that afternoon, we're going to have an aerobics class going on.
Okay.
So it's going to be some things happening, but for the most part, I might just
You'll
probably
be on
the
treadmill.
There. Yeah, I'll probably just be there probably by myself. We're going to be live streaming this, so you'll be able to see me on the treadmill mm-hmm. and also make a donation, which is
okay.
very important.
Right.
So, you know, so my wife asked me yesterday, she said, "What you want for your birthday?" I said, "I just want to get past this." I want to get past this.
Friday is coming.
Yeah.
Friday is coming.
But I enjoy it. Enjoy it, you know, and I look forward to Friday, and hopefully we'll have a lot of people come out and come and work out and also make a donation.
Yeah. Well, I know I went over to Welcome All Park with you for the first, and I lived on the South Side forever, and I had never been to that rec center. It's very nice, and you can feel the students, that they were just, you know, there were students there during the summer having a good time, and you can tell they enjoy coming there, right? You can feel it when you see the kids are in the gym playing basketball, and you know, someone playing outside, but you can tell that that's something that they feel like is theirs, and I think that's really important.
Yeah, but what we want to do is we want to build that teen population, and which is probably one of the hardest populations to get to come to a rec center,
right?
If they're not playing basketball,
yeah.
So you know, it's all about creating programs that cater to our young people. We are also partners with the City of Atlanta Parks and Recs.
Nice.
And we've been over in the Mechanicsville area probably for the last 10 years over in the Dunbar Community Center, where we have the only technology center in any Parks and Recs. And when we began that project, you know, they had no teens coming over there. Prior to COVID, you know, we would have 15, 20 kids trying to get into the studio to record. And we want to create that, you know,
in other places. Rick, when you first told me about this, what I thought, you know, we are in Atlanta, and I think that this story is mirrored in other cities as well, especially metropolitan cities like this. Mm-hmm. A lot of the crime, and there's a huge wave of crime that we've seen since COVID. And what was surprising to me was to learn that a lot of the crime at this point, the majority, is being committed by young people from ages like 12 to 18.
Drop down, son.
Even younger than 12?
Yes.
I know one of the candidates for mayor was carjacked by 14-year-old.
Yeah.
That we see that happening more and more. There was on the news last night, a 16-year-old killed his brother.
Yeah.
And so when you think about what can we do to reverse this trend, to me, programs like yours are really the only thing that you can do, because we don't want to be locking up and looking to police 11-year-olds and 12-year-olds and 13-year-olds. Those are babies.
Well, yeah, but here's the deal. We have to quit being so reactive to things. We got to be proactive.
There you go.
We have to catch these things on the front
end. Before they happen, absolutely.
Before they happen. Then, you know, when they happen, then everybody want to have a town hall meeting. And you have people coming in and talking just to hear themselves.
And not doing anything, absolutely.
And then once they leave, that's it.
Right.
No action, no action plans put in place.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not about all that talking.
Yeah.
Get the work.
Yeah.
Invest. And even if you're not doing it and you're a concerned citizen, help.
Right.
Put your money where your mouth is.
Mm-hmm.
You know, as a nonprofit, you know, nonprofits are not sexy.
Right.
There's nothing sexy about begging people for money.
Absolutely.
to help
children,
kids.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So for the last 17 years, I have put myself out there, not only me, but my wife and our executive director, James Caldwell, and begging with people to please join in. Help us save these kids.
Mm-hmm.
You know, this is what I do.
Right.
This is what I love to do, and I'm committed to it.
Mm-hmm.
And I know everybody is not going to do what I do, and that's okay, and I get it. But don't complain when a kid break in your house, steal your gun, carjack you, and now you want to complain when you could have invested in a program that could help these kids, take them off the street, put them in situations that they love, something that they want to do, expose them to something. And, you know, I'm not saying that what we do is the all in all.
Right.
Like, it's the cure for all of this violence.
But just get involved somewhere. Be doing something.
Right. I'm a music guy, so it was easy for me to say, hey, this is what I do.
And like I said, when I remember those statistics, a lot of these kids, that's what they're interested in. That is a great hook, because they see these, you know, you see Little Baby. I went to a Little Baby Chris Brown concert. That looks like a fun time.
Let me not say that, because I'm part of Big Brother, Big Sister, and my little brother is not in the music. I mean, they would pair me with a kid that's not in the music, right?
The only one, probably.
But he's in the technology.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying?
And music and technology at this point is,
You know, he wants to design games.
Mm-hmm.
He's a senior this year at South Cobb High School. So, but every conversation that I've that I've ever had with a young person, it always ties back to music, mm-hmm. even with adults.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, okay, you could be talking about something that has no relationship with music, mm-hmm. and it always it always ends up being about music,
mm-hmm.
whether it's their favorite artist or if they played an instrument in school.
Mm-hmm.
Something. It always ties into music. So,
yeah.
you know, you can't escape it. So you might as well join us. You might as well just come
on.
It's
not going to change.
It's not going to change. You know, when people can see careers of, you know, Lil Baby and all these other acts, and, you know, they see
success.
They see the success.
He looks like me. He's someone that I knew or I saw in the neighborhood, and now he's successful. I want that. So, you know, before we get out of here, I want you to tell people, because I think when people hear programs, a lot of times they don't put faces with that.
Mm-hmm.
Can you share maybe a couple of examples of success of kids that you've had an opportunity to impact, and now you're proud as you've been able to see that, you know, that fruit come to, that those seeds come to fruition in their lives?
Absolutely. Absolutely. One young man was, he's been with us for years. I graduated this past year. And he was one of our first student engineers,
mm-hmm.
Over in Mechanicsville, over at the Dunbar Center. Now he has a job with the city of Atlanta,
nice.
Parks and Recs.
Yeah.
This past summer, we were able to employ 10 student engineers where they got paid to teach other kids and to run studio sessions.
Nice.
We have a couple of kids that are going off to college. One young lady, she is moving to L.A.
Mm-hmm.
to pursue acting career. So she was one of our student engineers. So it's not just young men, but we have young women, and the young women that we have are incredible. They
mm-hmm.
woo, man, they they can run circles around some of these guys, and they actually know how to go in the studio and run a session.
Yeah. My daughter does that. She's an engineer.
Yeah, they know how to run Pro Tools and
mm-hmm.
Logic and all
yeah.
this stuff. They can run a studio session. And, you know, so those are some of the success stories that we have. And even this past summer, where we introduced another program where we are teaching kids how to screen print.
Oh, wow.
That program right there is going to
yeah.
probably be bigger than our music
yeah,
program.
Because you can automate.
Oh, my
it's
God.
It's merchandise. I can make money.
These
right?
kids, I mean, it was, you know, you didn't even have to say anything
mm-hmm.
to these kids. They
mm-hmm.
were so entrenched.
Mm-hmm.
And so focused on how to, you know, print
mm-hmm.
T-shirts.
Mm-hmm.
They was just amazed at the whole process.
It's
so
giving them a skill set, but it's also impacting them in a positive way. I do want to ask you, because you mentioned, you know, there are young ladies in the program as well, but I'm big on, I think, you know, a lot of these students come from single parent families, right?
Mm-hmm.
I was a single mom myself for years, and I know the difference of when a boy goes to school, a lot of times they don't see black men in the school system. They don't see black men at home. So when you have black men leading an organization like this, it allows them to see someone that looks like them that they can connect with.
Right.
Do you feel like there's definitely value? Because I had a charm etiquette class for girls, but I remember thinking, I don't really know, you know, I can't teach my son how to be a man, and I definitely can't teach other people's sons, you know,
right.
that.
Right.
So I think there's value in men leading often, because so often we haven't seen that.
No, especially in the nonprofit world, you
right.
have more females
absolutely.
That are running nonprofit organizations. And that was one thing for us. We wanted to make sure that we stood up
mm-hmm.
for
mm-hmm.
our young men. And, you know, a lot of times we might just sit down and just talk about life stuff.
Yeah,
you know what I'm
that's
saying?
That's important. That just is important.
It ain't always about, you know, how do you make a track or
mm-hmm.
you know, production, or you know, but how you doing?
Yeah,
what's going on?
Mm-hmm.
You know, we really want to be engaged with our young people, and that's something that we've always, you know, we've always done. It's
yeah.
just not we're vested
yeah.
in all of our young people that come through our program.
Mm-hmm.
Any way that we can help, that's what we do. It's not just you come show up at our program, leave, and that's it.
Right.
No, we're vested.
Yeah, we want to know where you at. What's going on?
what's going on at
yeah.
school? What's going on at the home? And one thing, too, is we want the parents to understand
yeah.
what the kids are doing.
That's a big the parent participation, and at least them understanding and appreciating it. Mm-hmm.
Yes, understanding it. Reinforcing the things that we teach our young people. So when they get home, parents know exactly,
mm-hmm.
hey, They have to reinforce these things. And for, you know, so far so good. I mean, it's been working. You know. And
well, I've seen you doing it, like I said, from the time I got here to Atlanta in 2005. You've been consistent, and I'm excited about Friday. Let people know the website they can go to if they want to make a donation. And also, of course, on Friday, where they can come if they want to work out a little bit, if they want to get a little sweat equity in the game.
Yep. So if you want to make a donation, you can go to our website, which is www.themeg.life, themed.life, or you can cash app us at $MusicEdGroup, MusicEdGroup. This will be live streamed on all social media platforms on Friday, our Facebook, Instagram, LinkedIn, all that good stuff. But most importantly, if you don't want to invest in our program, invest in somebody's program.
Absolutely.
Find something that sparks your interest. Music might not be the thing that you want to put your money into. It's just like making an investment for your future, you know. Put something in. Whatever you put in, you're going to get out. If you don't put nothing in, you're not going to get anything out. So invest in something, but we would rather you invest in MEG.
Absolutely.
So join us on Friday. I'll be there from 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. Come hang out with me. Come walk the track. Just show some support for our young people. This is what this is about. It's all about our young people.
Yeah, it's about our future, and we can't complain about it if we haven't done anything.
Yeah, put some skin in the game.
Yeah. Well, Ric, you got I got at least 45 minutes on the track of the treadmill. I got you for 45 minutes. Other than that, you know, I'm supporting in spirit.
Hey.
But I can only give you 45 minutes.
That's all good.
You know, that's all I got.
It's all good. It's all good.
Well, thank you so much for
joining
me.
Thank you for having
today.
Me, and thank you for your help.
Absolutely.
Putting this thing together.
Absolutely.
It's not easy running a nonprofit. It's not easy when you're asking people for money. You know, when you're a celebrity, you can get all the money in the world.
And for the wrong things.
For the wrong
I remember,
things.
You know, you can't even get your monthly retainer for PR, but you go to the strip club. But that's a whole nother
that's
story.
That's a whole nother story
that we're not talking about today.
Yep.
Thank you guys for joining me. I hope you got a lot out of this conversation. We're talking about children from two different perspectives. Make sure that you look up Defining Us, which drops today on Apple Music, all iTunes, and so many different places. You can look that up. And then also make sure that you at least visit the website, make a donation, or you can always come out and put a little sweat equity in. Like I said, if you come, I will definitely be there for 45 minutes getting something in. But it's a beautiful program, and I've seen firsthand how it affects the students here in Atlanta and so many other places. So that being said, hopefully you guys will tune in again next Tuesday for lunch. We're talking more relationships, pop culture, and all that jazz. This has been your host, Christal Jordan, from Christal With Love. See you next week.
I be in a loop, she be in a group. Brody want a friend, throwing alley-oop. Turn something to nothing.